I'm here with the gorgeous Carla Wren, who I am so, so, so excited to announce will be joining us at the Women in the New World Symposium in Hobart in October. Welcome, Carla.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
Oh, we are just beyond excited to have you. You know, your reputation absolutely precedes you. I was talking about you with a very prominent practitioner in our field a little while ago, and she said, if I ever get cancer, I know exactly where I'm going. Oh. I'm going straight to Carla. So you've absolutely got the reputation as the practitioner for practitioners, and you've got the reputation as being, you know, this really well-known oncology guru. How did that come about, Carla? How did you become interested in oncology?
Oh, it's actually a really funny story. I haven't shared it that much, but I had two children. I stayed at home for the first 4 years, and they're 2 years apart. So I felt like I'd been out of naturopathy for so long. I was like, how am I going to get back into it? I've forgotten everything. And so I thought, I'll just learn one area. I'll learn one area really well. And I decided to learn oncology and what was happening in our industry at the time in the US and the UK as far as integrative oncology and the use of complementary medicine really inspired me. And I was like, there's so much research and no one's talking about it. So I read the research and did some training and kind of just extended from there. So I probably could have found an easier specialty, but I believe everything happens for a reason. So here we are.
And I agree. It's, you know, I actually have a really similar story in my background as well, that when I was lecturing in natural medicine over in the UK, actually, a long time ago, coming up for 18 years ago, I think. Mm-hmm. And I also took on this whole unit of oncology nutrition because no one else wanted to teach it.
Wow.
I was just overwhelmed by how interesting it was, how much research there was. And also just from a practitioner perspective, how much you could actually do as well. You know, research there is in nutrition being the foundation of wellness and how this relates to people undergoing treatment for cancer. And then also how that then kind of springs out to cancer as a chronic disease as well.
Yes.
And
yes.
That, you know, oncology ties in so nicely with this whole concept of the Western style life of chronic disease, which is also an area that you're well known for specializing in, chronic disease, right?
Yeah, so I feel like it's a great opportunity for us, both chronic disease and oncology. I guess being a chronic disease is a really great place for us to showcase all our skills, whether it be talking about the microbiome or talking about the immune system or inflammation or all these drivers right down to lifestyle factors. You know, the areas where patients are really looking for help, because unfortunately there's an element of not getting that from standard care, and we really have the tools to be able to support them in that way.
Well, I'm so grateful that you heard that calling, you followed it, and now you have the Peninsula Herbal Dispensary, which is really well regarded. Tell me a little bit about your business, because I'd love to hear about how you came to grow this business with such an extraordinary name.
Thank you. So I always credit Karen Jackson, who was the founder of the Herbal Dispensary. And I was really fortunate to be able to work with Karen. She was a mature age student when I was at college, so I met her that way. And it was really a passion of hers, the dispensary. And she employed me as a naturopath. And we had a very well-known naturopath at the time who they kind of called like the spiritual one or the energetic one. And I got their name as the scientific naturopath, which I think in the early 2000s was really like new for us. And I talked a lot about the research and really delved into that, and so my reputation just grew. I put on my business cards, I love the complex cases, which I don't know if that's the best thing to do, but it worked for me. In 2015 I was lucky enough to buy the business with my husband, and it just kind of grown from there. So now we lose count, we always joke about how many of our beautiful team we have, but there's at last count 12 of us, and we have, I think it's, yeah, 9 naturopaths, and then we have some 3 support staff. And so, you know, it's a really beautiful environment, and very fortunate to be able to collaborate and work with so many amazing women. We only have one man, which is my husband, so I feel like he gets the token.
He's a special one, obviously.
Yes, he's a special one, and he puts up with us all in our fabulous glory. But, yeah, we are women-owned and led. So, yeah, super passionate and love working with all the team down here.
Well, thank you for everything you do for our profession and for, you know, for your community. And, you know, from the perspective of our symposium, you're actually bringing a different slant to your presentation with us. Your presentation is called You Are Number One, Putting Yourself First in Business. Tell me a little bit about what inspired you to talk about this topic and why it's something that's so important to you.
Yeah, so I hope it interests everyone. And of course, I'm always willing to share on all the complex cases in oncology and things like that. But I felt like your topic really called me to do something different. And so I haven't shared a lot about my story in oncology. And certainly, I've never had a cancer diagnosis. My mum has, and that was where another part of the journey. But what I learned through all of this is that our patient loads are really heavy. And our ability to cope with those requires us to put ourselves first as clinicians and in whatever circumstance we are in our lives, as mothers or carers or partners. And I surveyed some practitioners in our industry in Australia and New Zealand around how they were putting themselves first, or whether they were putting themselves first, and asked them a lot of data around, were they feeling overwhelmed in their practice? Have they ever actioned a plan to support their mood and emotional health while working with patients? And I got some really amazing data out of that. And it was quite shocking. And it's something that I wanted to bring to everyone's attention, is we need to put ourselves first. So as a bit of a, you know, intro, like 88% of the respondents said they felt overwhelmed in their practice regularly. And I think, you know, in different industries, if we look at the emergency services, who are really face-to-face with patients sometimes, or clients sometimes on their worst days, they have lots of support, and their industries have settings where people are able to access support if they're feeling traumatized or overwhelmed. And unfortunately, when you look at our industry, there really isn't a formalized structure to help patients, rather practitioners, put themselves first and deal with the trauma or overwhelm they might be experiencing in their clinic. So I wanted to bring some attention to this, and not just highlight the fact that our patients might be stressing us or causing us to feel overwhelmed as practitioners, but also give everyone a bit of an actionable plan from my experience of what we can do to really make sure we are putting ourselves first and we don't feel from that empty cup, which is a saying I love.
Absolutely. And that rings so true, because it's something I've often pondered, actually. We are a profession who are overwhelmingly dominated by women who care, essentially, who come into being as practitioners because we care so much about helping other people, and we have such a high burnout rate.
Yes.
You know, I really, when I think about all the years I've spent as a lecturer in natural medicine and saying to every generation of student, kind of, there's only a really small percentage of students who go into long-term practice, because so many of them burn out. So start thinking about this now in your first few years of student life. Start thinking about how you're going to protect yourself from burnout and look after yourself. And this is, you know, I feel like this is a really important message that you'll be bringing to our practitioner community who are, you know, established and successful. They've still got to keep an eye on, like you said, filling their own cups and really keeping watch for that, you know, that burnout, because it's very hard to come back from burnout as well.
Definitely. And just I think the level of patients that we're seeing, and obviously my oncology patients bring a whole emotional journey with them, but it's any patients. If you're working in fertility, there's obviously the emotional journey of successful and unsuccessful pregnancies, and working with children that are maybe having challenges, especially given the last couple of years. I think, you know, everyone's mental health has taken a bit of a hit and all the stats support that. But as practitioners, we're really carrying a big load for our patients, and being able to work out how to manage that, I think, is an important part of our business. And beautiful practitioners like Tammy, who I know is on the speaking stand with me, is you know, someone that's always shared about burnout. I just want to take it to that next step and really give everyone an actionable plan and some good ideas about how to work and support these patients, even if they are some of the more complex or overwhelming ones, or they're pressing your buttons, making you feel a bit challenged.
Oh, amazing. I can't wait to hear all the wisdom that you have to share. And I know it's going to hit some people right where they need to hear it. From your perspective, looking at the lineup of incredible speakers we have, who are you most excited to hear at the symposium?
Do you know what? I'm just excited to be there in person.
Me too.
I don't even think I can choose. You know, I'm like a fangirl for so many of these practices, and I think this is one of the most beautiful things about the women in our industry. People like Tammy and Kira and Jules, you know, we have had each other's backs through all of this, and I'm just really excited to share this experience with all of them and to meet a whole lot of new people too, because I really miss that part of our industry. We've got so many beautiful people and inspiring women, and I think you pick up something from the people you spend these kind of weekends and events with.
Yeah, I agree. I think connection is the most powerful thing. It's something we've missed so much over the last couple of years. I just can't wait to be there and to give everyone the biggest hugs.
I know, yes.
Well, Carla, thank you so much for your time today. And thank you again in advance for everything you're going to be giving us at the symposium. And we'll look forward to seeing you there. Thank you so much.
Thank you.